What's good, everybody? It's Kenneth Bear here. Another episode of Touchdowns and Tangents. Cool, man. We got a lot to talk about tonight. Honestly, just getting here was ridiculous. 7-10 is trash. But most importantly, man, we're going to have some guests on tonight. Sooner rather than later, actually. There's been a lot of recaps. Pete went out to cover the NFL PA Bowl last week. We got some people calling in from Four Press Coverage. But most importantly, man, I'm going to get to it later, but that J. Cole track, Mental Child, like, y'all have no idea how close I was to just opening the show with that. It holds a special place in my heart as a middle child. So, yeah, I was feeling pretty petty when it came out. I was like, yeah, I'm slandering my siblings with this song repeatedly. But most importantly, man, want to shout out all our affiliates. Obviously, starting with the Good News Radio. I mean, come on. I kind of, like, that's just, it goes without saying, you know, Good News Sports, excuse me. Also, you know, shout out to Courtside, they just did their thing. Honestly, when it comes to basketball, those were the only people I actually want to hear their opinions. So, shout out to all of them, man, they're doing their thing. But, most importantly, because the pettiness that has gone on in the Full Press Coverage group chat, it's been legendary this week. I just want to personally say shout out to Terry, Obi. I'm terrible, man. Wow, I'm totally spacing out on everyone's name in that group chat, even though I know everyone's name in that group chat. I also forgot Pete's name. CT, man, it's killer. Well, there you go. First call of the night. Hello, caller. State your name and where you're from.
My name is Malik Obi, and I am from Maryland. And how you doing tonight, fellas?
Doing good. Pete's not here. He has some business. But, man, now we got to give you a better introduction than that. First off, this man has a hate. No, I'm just starting with the I don't think people understand. Man, this man, Obi, does so much great work. Great journalist out of the DMV.
Thank you.
One of the, I'm going to give you another hand. I got to give a hand clap for the DMV. All the people I know. Plus, if I don't, like, the females I know from the DMV will kill me. And I'm not ready to go yet. But most importantly, man.
Thank you, man.
Your hatred of Reggie Nelson and that Mario Wyans I Don't Want to Know video, like, nah, and their knowledge of HBCUs, we're going to get into all that, but, like, I just want people to know those three things. Like, if I had a trident of, like, I don't know, just something that's really dignified and really honorable and, like, the highest honor that was made out of gold, Obi would be holding it, because three of my favorite things... HBCU culture, even though I actually never went to one, but I'm fascinated with it. And all the players, because, you know, I really have a feeling. Me, personally, I feel like if all the top recruits, all the black players went to all the HBCUs, we'd see a continental shift. But that's, we'll get into that. And mostly, yeah, I really hated that that video when it came out, that song. I Don't Want to Know. That's the simplest thing I've ever heard in my life. I don't want to know if you play me. I think if you don't want to know, you probably know you're being played.
Exactly.
Is it just me? Like, I feel like Drake covered this already. Like, he had a couple albums where we covered this, but for some reason Mario Wayans thought in between. I feel like there was an era where we, like, it was like a 5-minute pit stop, and Mario Wayans just snuck that in, kind of the way Tory Lanez keeps sneaking in disses at rappers. But anyway, You got a book.
I want to say first and foremost, I want to say thank you for having me, and I appreciate that wonderful introduction. And we are going to go into all these things. But I'm going to let you finish what you were saying, but we're going to go on all of these topics tonight. I wanted to thank you, Peace Man. I wanted to thank him as well. I'm very grateful to be on the show tonight.
Appreciate it. We wanted this to happen before, but hey, it's timing. Everything works out. Full press coverage, brethren. Your Twitter bio says, published author has a book called Bounce, Beat, Baby. Give a little just in-depth, you know, analysis of what that is. Why everybody
okay,
should get
it. So, you know, Washington, D.C. area, I should say, you know, the definitive music of our area is go-go music. And, you know, people think that that's like, you know, just as any other genre, there are subgenres. So go-go is the overall music of the area. The bounce beat sound is similar to rap, when rap went from, you know, the hobby, to kind of like getting more lyricism, until you had the off branch of gangster rap from, you know, the West Coast, et cetera. You know, this subgenre. So the bounce beat is the main subgenre of go-go. It is the sound of go-go for everyone, I'd say, 30 and under. You know, it really came about between 2000 and 2003. And, you know, those were the years, you know, I actually moved to Maryland from New York in 1999. So I kind of like, I literally came up in the area, that era. Once I actually figured out that I actually liked go-go, and you know, that time, the last 20 years, basically was the growth of this sound. You know, so I was there, I was going to school through that time, and you know, it's hard to really explain in a short manner like this. But go-go, like I said, it is the sound of the area. Is, you know, and there was a time, you know, where life kind of revolved around go-go, everything go-go related. You know, go-go is fashion, go-go is slang, everything is for our area. So I said, I'm going to write a book about my specific era of go-go, my sights, my smells, my everything, all type of experiences. And the major inspiration for it was West Coast related. It's one of my favorite, probably my second favorite book ever, is Monster by Sayeka Shakur, aka Monster Cody, a very notorious Crip, a notorious gangbanger. He wrote a book while he was in prison about his time and upbringing, and, you know, basically during the second generation of the Crips. And, you know, he's very detailed, and the way that he was passionate about the Crips is how I was passionate about go-go and about having some of those similar experiences with the violence, with everything that went on. I said, I'm gonna write a book about this. And the book is really doing really well. It's available on Amazon. It's available on iTunes, Barnes & Noble, everywhere. It's doing very good. It's doing a lot better than I expected, I'll say that, especially considering the numbers that I'm getting outside of our immediate area. You know, people are like, well, I don't really know what that is, but I'm going to try it. And if, or they might, you know, they might know a few go-go songs through movies or whatever the case may be. They say, well, let me see what this perspective is like. So it's been a great experience.
That's what's up. We got a couple more questions, and then we'll get to the sports stuff. But this is culture, and that's part of what this podcast has always been about, is, you know, culture and people in the culture actually having a say-so of what goes on. And your story is an amazing one. First question for Pete. I don't know, you might laugh when you hear this. Is Wale in the book?
Yes.
Let me tell you something. Is Florin in it?
You can't. Yes. You cannot tell the story of the last 20 years of go-go without talking about Wale. Because Wale, to the mainstream world, this is a funny thing. Mainstream, the country, the world, accepts Wale as accepts and respects Wale as a rapper. There are a lot of people who don't respect Wale as a person. They think he's a crybaby, whatever the case may be. You know, it's funny to see people on a national level have an issue with Wale over whatever it is. But Wale, his start in rap paralleled so well with the go-go world. It's like he really essentially got his start in go-go, but he got his start, you know, what he did in go-go opened people's eyes to him as a rapper. This area is the transformation. That's what I talked about in the book. The transformation of this area is really ridiculous. Like, if you think about it, think about this, Barry. Let's say from 2010 back, you personally, how many rappers have you ever listened to from the Washington, D.C. area? Rappers.
I'll probably say like five, but it wasn't like they had a wave around that time. But my thing is, because I lived in Oakland and came out here in 99, like August 99.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't really get into hip hop truly, truly until around, you know, 2000, like 2001. So Wale was one of my favorites just because I was like, this dude just sounds like he's enigmatic when he raps. Like, I was just drawn to, like, okay, what, I don't know what that sound is, what that style is. I thought it was just created in the studio. I didn't know, like, oh, wait, this is heavily influenced.
Influenced, yeah. Now, the thing about that is that the D.C. area is not, you know, before Shy Glizzy, before Fat Trail, et cetera, there was such a small contingency of people that actually wanted to rap. Now, let me say this. People in D.C. and Maryland and Virginia, before 2010, 93% of people's time listening to music was listening to go-go, and that's a fact. You can ask anybody. That other 7%, it was listening to go-go from some. Well, the other 6% was listening to go to rap from somewhere else. Scarface is like the god of DC in terms of rappers that's not actually from DC. Scarface can go anywhere in DC and do whatever he wants.
And Ghetto Boys, you know what I'm saying? Playing tricks on me.
Ghetto
our
Boys,
theme song.
Scarface, Lil Wayne, Juvenile, anybody. West or Midwest, anybody anywhere below Philly is loved in DC in terms of rap. You know, prior to 2010, 2008, you know, but Wale, he was doing his rap thing, and he, you know, was, he kind of grew up in the go-go world, and he was able to use his rap skills to get on with some go-go bands. His hit single "Pretty Girls."
Oh, I was gonna ask you about that. Like every time I hear
it's actually derived from two songs. It's actually derived from "Back Up." Now, this is to tie this all together. He has in the chorus of the song is Wincy, who's probably the most known, most famous go-go singer from the band Backyard Band. Now, the lead mic or the face of Backyard Band is Big G. Big G is Stringer. I mean, excuse me. Big G is Slim Charles from The Wire. So, if you ever watch The Wire, Slim Charles is, you know, he's actually the person at the end of the show that takes over the co-op. He's the king of Baltimore at the end of the show. But he's from D.C. And that's a whole nother story. We get into the D.C.-Baltimore relationship. But to come back to Wale, Wale got his start in go-go. And the mixtape that he put out was very early. Mixtapes were so great that people said, you know, was going to get behind him. And the go-go world got behind him. And then everybody else that was like, you know, backpackers, everybody was just like, okay, Wale, this is our guy. This is the one that's going to get us out. He's going to get us out there as a rapper. You know, Tabby Bonet, there were other people, you know, but Wale was the guy. You know what I'm saying? And he got out. He did his thing a couple of years later. Shy Glizzy, Fat Trail, et cetera, came about. And the thing is that when Shy Glizzy and Fat Trail came out, these are two people that grew up in the go-go as well. When they came out, the area itself had changed so much, just as Oakland and LA, et cetera, all these places are going through gentrification. DC has seen a complete facelift. Everybody knows that DC was once considered Chocolate City.
Exactly.
And now it's like gluten-free, macadamia nut, you know.
Nut allergies everywhere.
Yeah, it's completely different city. You know, people are, you know, the city, the culture of the city is like clinging on for dear life. So, yes, Wale is in the book. And my perspective is seeing, like I said, I was in high school when Wale came out. You know, I was going to Go-Go's and seeing Wale performing. So I have this whole thing of, like, I've seen Wale perform for free maybe 15 to 20 times. So me paying to see Wale now is not, like, being cheap. It's just like, you know, I came up seeing Wale, and I'm very happy for his growth. But, you know, me saying, hey, I'm going to pay to go see Wale, that's kind of weird to me. Because I've seen him go from, like, you know, the local rapper to, like, a megastar, you know. So in the book, I had to talk about Wale's impact for people nationally and people that weren't in the Go-Go world but from the area, for them to understand where he came from. But I also had to talk about how territorial D.C. is. D.C. is a really crazy place. Like, being from D.C., to D.C. people is the greatest thing ever. Being from Maryland to D.C. people is the worst thing ever. So the whole controversy about Wale, the whole controversy about Wale is that he was born in D.C., but he grew up in Maryland. So, like, for D.C. people, that's, like, the worst thing ever. You know, it's like, oh, hell no. You didn't live in D.C. your entire life. You didn't. I can't go outside and see you on the street you said you grew up on right now. Oh, we're discrediting you. So that's why, along with some of the things that happen behind the scenes, whether it be rumors or not, you know, there's a bitter taste in some people's mouth in the area about Wale. But at the end of the day, there's a great contingency in the area of people that want to see Wale do good and are happy for his success. And I have watched him grow. And I'm one of those people. So the book talks about everybody that you would know, Shy Glizzy, et cetera. You know, and there were people like Michael Beasley, Kevin Durant, et cetera, that I grew up seeing in the Go-Go when they were just regular people. Quinn Cook, who just won a championship with the Golden State Warriors. Quinn Cook was, he's close friends with a very popular Go-Go band called T.O.B. You know, I've seen Quinn Cook in the Go-Go for years before I even knew he was a basketball player. This is our culture. You know, it was just a thing that you did. You know, if you play football or basketball in high school, when the game is over, you're going to the Go-Go. You know, I was so close to skipping my prom because it was going to be this big, elaborate Go-Go. And I was like, man, I can't do that. I got to have these memories. I'm kind of happy I did it, but I ended up going to the Go-Go late that night. But that's a whole different story. But yeah, so the book is for the people that have ever heard Go-Go, for the people, especially the people here, it's a great book because it's my perspective on some of the most magical times of my life. For those that don't know, they might have heard the Go-Go, they might not know what it is. I feel like I give a great description and breakdown of what the culture is, what the music is, and then and how it affected my life. You know, like I said, I came from New York City. When I first got here, I was like, what the hell is Go-Go? I couldn't stand it for maybe six months, and then it was just like, it just hit me, and I was like, okay, I love it, and it just changed my life.
Stop fighting. You're like, all right, let me embrace this. But that's what's up. kind of 1.5 questions, so I'll just throw out Pete's first. He said, what about Virginia and Baltimore? Because I know, like, when you're talking about how Wale's from Maryland but grew up in D.C., it's the same thing, like, when you're from, when you say you're from the East Bay, let's say you say, oh, you're from Oakland, but you grew up in San Francisco. It's kind of like that, like Hunter's Point. It's like, you're in the Bay Area, but you weren't where things were actually popping off. So when it when it comes down to Go-Go, for my question specifically, I hear R&B, and I hear a lot of artists kind of trying to find a sound, play with the same sound. And I hear, like, some of the same melodies over and over again. I hear, like, when I saw one of the Go-Go videos you posted, it was like church at one point. It was like church and a concert. And it was like, it was so much going on. It was hectic, but it was just like, you could feel the energy. Like, it felt like one of those old, like, oh, I don't want to say like old slave energy because it just has a negative connotation, but like an old, like an old, I don't know.
I
like
get what you're
like
saying. Exactly what you're saying.
Like an old time, it's rich. Like, the energy there feels like it goes back probably like 1,000 years. You know what I mean? So, like, how would you say Go-Go has really influenced that region, the South, and most importantly, R&B?
Okay. So, let me answer Pete's question first. First, it's exactly like you said in terms of the East Bay. The area is so, it's so confrontational. So, you got Baltimore, which is in Maryland, But Baltimore is looked at by D.C. and surrounding areas, which would be D.C., PG County, et cetera, Virginia, as like, ugh, like, you know, it's a respect thing because, you know, Baltimore's like, you know, it's a gangster city. But it's like, it's like, you know, for 45 minutes away, the slang is different. The fashion is different. Everything is different. They're still doing heroin. It's really different, you know.
Yikes.
But now, D.C. is like, this is the thing about D.C. It's the nation's capital. And it's not just the go-go thing, but it's like people are so territorial about D.C. because of for so many reasons, especially black people. It's like, this is somewhere we came, you know, we migrated here from the South. Now, let me say this, first of all. We don't look at D.C. area as the South. We look at it as the Middle East. From Philly to Virginia, Northern Virginia is what I would consider the Middle East. You go, like, to Norfolk, Hampton, Richmond, all that, et cetera, I think that's the South.
Yeah,
like,
that Charleston,
completely different.
Yeah, that has a real Southern, downtown vibe to it.
So when we talk about D.C., Maryland, and Virginia, people that are really like from the streets or from like the inner cities of these areas don't even like to say the term DMV. That's something that's a political thing. That's a entertainment industry thing. That's a collective thing. Like, I'm going out of town somewhere.
Interesting.
I play basketball, I rap or whatever. That's, I will never say that. I kind of like cringe when people say I'm from the DMV. It's not something I don't say. Because of the fact that I grew up in a time when it was so confrontational. It's like, you know, like I said, DC people, there are DC people that hate Wale because his mom decided to move and give him a better life and move to Montgomery County, which is like a pretty affluent county, a good mix of all cultures, a lot of Africans, a lot of Ethiopians, you know, Sierra Leone, et cetera, Mexicans, black, white, everything. But it's a great education system. So people want to move and, you know, do better for their children. So while they happen to move to a pretty affluent area, and, you know, when he became a rapper, he's like still trying to rap his D.C. hood. But it's like, well, people are like, you know, trying to point out, oh, you grew up over here, whatever, whatever. So, you
went to Cranbrook. That's
County.
A private school. Yeah. Like one of those, like, the Papa Doc situation.
So, like, under D.C. is PG County. Like, PG County is like the epicenter of Maryland. Like, you know, we have such a rich history. Like, in my city, Landover, Maryland is like the city of cities. So, it's like you got the greats. You got Sugar Ray Leonard. You got Martin Lawrence. You got Len Bias. You got so many people. And then right next door, C. Pleasant, you got Kevin Durant. I mean, you can, and then you got the copious amounts of people in the NFL, the NBA, entertainment, et cetera. You know, you got Taraji P. Henson, who's from the other side of PG, Oxon Hill. Every, you know, Myers from Greenbelt, Delonte West, every little quarter of, you know, every little corner of PG has produced somebody that you know. And it's every day somebody new, you know? So it's like we set the tone for Maryland, you know, outside of Baltimore. And then it's like you got Montgomery County, which, like I said, it's, you know, everywhere. The world is a ghetto. So there are lower income areas.
Preach.
But it's a pretty nice county, you know. And then Virginia, Northern Virginia, you have the Pentagon, and then you have, you know, the outlining areas of that. And, you know, you have some pretty bad areas along Richmond Highway, which is like really hood. And then it's like, besides that, it's like, hey, this is a place, it's a commonwealth. This is a place where I can go raise a family, pretty decent area. I can get some extremely high speed and tickets. A lot of people don't like Virginia for a lot of reasons. The tickets and
exactly. It
being a commonwealth is like a major reason. And then it's like, you know,
what's
as
a commonwealth
that we say as,
for people who don't know? Because I know Mike Vick is from Virginia Beach, I think.
Yeah, so it's like, the Commonwealth is like, the way I sum it up is like, extremely egregious laws. Like, you know, you go, you know, D.C., you bust a U-turn illegally, hey, don't do that again. Virginia, you might do 2 years in jail, you know?
Damn.
So it's like, everything is like, it's over the top. You know, it's really easy to go to jail in Virginia. As you see with Mike Vick, Allen Iverson, everybody, it's a scary place to live in a sense. But yeah, that's more Southern Virginia. But Northern Virginia, it's a political suburb. You know, it's like it's right outside of D.C. You know, so people are like, you know, I'm trying to escape D.C. I'm moving to Virginia. So it's like the D.C. area is like really territorial, really controversial. So it's like everybody's kind of like against each other. But, you know, you go somewhere else, it's like, yeah, I'm from this area, you know. But more so, people are so determined to set up their individual area. Like, you know, now we're at the point where I can say I'm from PG County. And somebody in Nebraska might know what the hell that is, you know? So it's like, it doesn't really do anything for the unity. But for the experience that we went through to put ourselves on the map, it's a great thing. So to answer your question, go-go is like, it is about the feeling, you know what I'm saying? So the basis of go-go music started with Chuck Brown, the late Chuck Brown. He was making original music. And he was tying cover songs into original music to get his original music heard. And he was doing, he had a cover band and it was a few other bands, but he was the main one. And what they were doing were to, instead of giving a, you know, a break between songs, they kept, you know, they had hand signals or whatever to change songs and keep the music going, keep people on the dance floor. And that's where the term go-go came from. Just kept going and going and going. So from the 60s to the 80s and 90s, that went from 3 or 4, 10 bands to hundreds, you know? So you got hundreds of bands all trying to carve out their own niche. It's a great thing, you know? DC go-go is really heavily based on instruments. So it's like, you know, you got that kid in the inner city, he might be in Section 8, but he has nothing else in his room but a Casio keyboard. He's great on his keyboard because he wants to be in a go-go band. He wants to provide for his family, you know, and that leads you to other places. I have a friend from Southeast DC, and, you know, pretty bad neighborhood. He started out as a keyboarder in a go-go band, and now he's a keyboarder for Donnell Jones, you know, and amazing. Genuine, all these people, you know, he's a keyboarder for the Stars. So it's a great thing. You know, if you're musically inclined, you're musically inclined, but this is an area that really appreciates it. The thing about go-go is that it's all about the live sound, you know what I'm saying? So every band is looking to see which song that we can do, cover, or create on our own. That's going to get the girls, you know, shaking their behinds and the dudes partying or whatever, not mean mugging, standing on the wall. So that's what go-go is about. It's all about the feeling. So if a band has 30 minutes to perform, they're looking for that one song that's going to get everybody in the place partying, you know? So it's all about feeling. It's all about feeling. You know, we're so, in so many other genres, we're so used to the studio creating the hits. And then it's being brought to the clubs or whatever. And go-go is the complete opposite. It's very rare to have a studio album, you know. So
yeah,
we remember albums and CDs by dates, you know. So,
yeah.
we remember these things by dates, you know, and then that has so much importance. So, like, you go to the club, you know, what go-go does is a lot of call and response. So like the early days of hip hop is like, where Brooklyn at, you know, or all my ladies scream, you know, but it's like that, but it's more so like the neighborhoods, you know, so we don't have Bloods and Crips here. We're more so like neighborhoods or groups. So the groups, you know, I mean, essentially you can look at that as gangs, but we're more so a neighborhood based area. We're like one of the few areas that hasn't been invaded by the mainstream, the known gangs, the Bloods, the Crips, the Pirates, the Latin Kings, et cetera, we're more so neighborhoods. So it's like you might have an Asian, a Mexican, a black dude, a white dude, et cetera. They're all from the same neighborhood, you know? And, you know, it's not that much division in terms of gangs or groups, you know? So it's like everybody's trying to get their neighborhood shouted out. And then you got somebody, it might be your birthday, you know? So you want to hear your birthday on that CD recording. You want to hear your name or whatever. So it's like, I'm going to remember that day. That was 1/19/2019. So when the CD comes out, I'm going to the store to get that. Well, I'm going to have to download that because it means something to me. Well, that was when they hit this song and I love this song. Or they covered a Jasmine Sullivan song or whatever. And only Go-Go can put a twist on it like they do, because it's like, you know, when you hear a band, a cover band, cover a song, they're trying to hit it the exact same way, you know? But Go-Go is like, if they do a cover song, it's a twist on it. It might just be six bars out of the hook, or it might be, you know, it might be the basis of one song, and then you got the rapper up there rapping a whole nother song or freestyling his own verse or whatever. It's all about creativity. And that's where the live, and that's where the energy comes from. You don't know what's going to happen in the Go-Go, you know? So you got one band performing and somebody comes in like, and that's the thing about it. When you, nowadays, when rappers come to town, to DC, they come to, you know, to the club to perform. But when I was growing up, like, rappers came to DC to perform with Go-Go bands. So, you know, if you're a rapper, like everybody, I'm talking everybody from Ice Cube to Biggie to Tupac, everybody. There's live CD recordings, there's live tape recordings. This is all out there, public record. You know, you can ride past the older dude and he's listening to Junkyard Band, a CD from a tape from 1994, and it's Tupac rapping on it or whatever, or Ice Cube or whatever. You know, so it's like, for that out of town artist, it's up to them to you know, be able to rap on that beat or sing on that beat and, you know, find the groove, you know, just as they would if they, you know, DJ Quick was performing with a live band or something like that. It's a beautiful thing. It's something that we take to the next level, and we have something that we can cherish. And we don't, you know, and that was another reason for me to write that book. I wanted people to look back and appreciate this and say, we can't lose this. Gentrification is really destroying this area. And our culture is all we're going to have left. Once all of the houses and the housing projects and everything is gone, we cannot let that be destroyed. You know, so I thought it was up to me to say, let's create a discussion and keep the culture going, you know, and inspire somebody else to write a book or do a documentary or something like that. Let's keep this going.
That is beautiful. Oh, man. Like, I want to buy, like, multiple copies of your book now. Like, I was already, was like, you know what? From being from East Oakland, and, like, my grandparents, my grandfather's from Louisiana, my grandma's from Alabama, it's crazy to think, like, most of us don't know, like, a lot about past our grandparents. So, like, right. I was fortunate enough to go back home to Oakland over Christmas and learn some things about my family. And I was like, okay, well, if I have these connections here, like, what was the culture like then? And, like, Louisiana, we already know what it's like. Bounce. Right. That's why, I like, when you were talking about, you know, playing live instruments and, you know, keyboard, I'm thinking of, like, trumpets, and I'm thinking of all the different sounds that would meld into Go-Go. And it's crazy to think, you know, that is a piece of history. Like, you never... Like, you can gentrify an area, but you can never, like, get rid of the sound, like, almost like the heartbeat of an area. So that's fantastic. And also, to kind of transition into, you know, sports side, because there's, you kind of already talked about, you know, athletes, but you went to an HBCU.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead and shout out your school.
The illustrious Morgan State University. The illustrious Morgan State University, as we're called. There are plenty of HBCUs, but there's only one illustrious Morgan State University.
Didn't Vishanta Shanko go there?
Yes, sir. And that segues into this conversation perfectly. Vishanta Shanko,
tight end.
Willie Lanier. Yes, from Morgan State. Vikings legend, you know. Willie Lanier, Chiefs legend. We got some legends. You know, we have four NFL Hall of Famers. We have, I believe, 8 or 9 Black College Football Hall of Famers. You know, so we are one of those HBCUs that started the trend of players going to the NFL. We have that. We have that legacy. And, you know, this year we have an opportunity to have our first player drafted in 15 years in guard Joshua Miles, who just came back from the Shrine Game. Yes, he had a pretty decent performance. So, you know, HBCUs mean so much to me. You know, I grew up and I really didn't, you know, I knew I wanted to go to college. My college choices as a kid were influenced by basketball. It's like, you know, Allen Iverson went to Georgetown. Maybe I should go to Georgetown. But I was a really big Connecticut UConn fan. So I was like, you know, I was determined to either go to UConn and play basketball or Miami and play football. You know, I played both sports in high school, but it was like, that's not going to happen. So it was like, once it was, you know, I had to look at, you know, other means of saying, hey, let me figure out where I actually do want to go to school, you know. And, you know, I'm a first generation HBCU student and graduate. I have a few people in my family that went to college, but I'm the first in my immediate family to finish. But I'm going to be the first one to start the tradition of going to an HBCU. And the thing about the East Coast is that, especially from New York down, is that the culture is so rich in HBCU history. From New York to Georgia, over to Tennessee, to Arkansas, et cetera, there are a great amount of families where the father went to an HBCU. He probably went to the HBCU and met his wife there, your mom, you know? And they, you know, there's a great history of the parents, both, you know, the dad being in a fraternity, the mother being in a sorority, or just, you know, like I said, just being HBCU grad. You know, it's a beautiful thing. And it's something that's so relevant here. And one of the greatest shows in terms of representation of that was the short-lived Nickelodeon show, My Brother and Me. You know, when people go back and watch that show, it was really ahead of its time. It was a black family living in Charlotte, which is like one of the epicenters of blackness right now. And they both were HBCU graduates. They wore HBCU stuff. They represented their fraternities and sororities on every episode. It's a lifestyle here, you know? So, you know, when I went on college tour with my high school, we didn't go to Maryland, University of Maryland. We didn't go to Towson. We didn't go to University of Virginia. We went to the black schools, you know, because it was like, hey, you guys can make the decision to go where you want, but we're going to introduce you to, you know, the schools of your people, of your culture. You know, so I went to Hampton, I went to North Carolina A&T, and I said, you know what, Morgan is for me. I felt good. I felt, you know, and it was a great experience for me because I was able to, like so many of my peers from this area, you know, get rid of those stereotypes that we have about Baltimore when you're out there and really experience it. Baltimore's, you know, for the drugs, you know, problem that they have and everything and the crime and everything, it's a very cultured city. It's a very historic city. You know, I love Baltimore now. You know, I lived out there for quite a few years. I really loved it, you know, and in the proximity to D.C., it was far enough from my parents, but it was, you know, it was close enough for me to get home if need be. But I got to the point where I really loved being out there, you know, and I had the best of both worlds. I had Baltimore and I had D.C. culture running through my veins, you know, and Baltimore people are great, you know, great people. It's a blue collar city, you know, kind of like forgotten. It's one of the last cities on the East Coast to be gentrified, to not be gentrified yet. And it's like, you know what, you know, people are like, you know, we got to just overcome. We got to do it and we got to get to it. There's nothing that we can do but to do it. So, you know, with the HBCU culture, man, it's so great. It's so great. And the thing is that I went to a northern HBCU. So you got, you know, Howard, you got Morgan, you got Lincoln, you got Hampton, et cetera. Those are what I would consider northern HBCUs, you know, beautiful women, beautiful campuses and stuff. But the north, you know, the school support and school spirit is like, you know, people love their HBCUs, but it's more so, you know, these northern places, Norfolk State, et cetera, Ocala, Quinn, all these schools, they have a better possibility of, until guys like Tariq Cohen, of being notorious for basketball. So, you know, the football games are, you know, people are more so worried about the tailgating and everything than actually the football game. But that's changing. But the southern HBCUs are so great because it's like you can go down to Grambling. Man, let me tell you.
My mom went to
Howard is Grambling. Known as the greatest homecoming in black culture. But if you go to Grambling, you go to North Carolina Central. I'm talking about my brother went to North Carolina Central. I went down there. and he played for the team. And we're talking about a black area where you drive through after 11 a.m. and everything in the city, in the town is shut down because everybody's at the game. They got the ribs slow cooking, you know, chitlins, et cetera. The whole town comes out. The whole city comes out. That spirit. And then the culture of HBCUs is like, just as much as it is the sports, it's the music, it's the band. The greatest irony in America is how people view bands at PWIs, predominantly white institutions, versus how we view bands at HBCUs. HBCUs, you're going to get a show. It doesn't matter if the team is losing 30 to nothing. People are sitting in their seats at halftime because they know that that band is going to put on an electrifying show. They're going to hit some of the greatest songs ever, Frankie Beverly and May, Stevie Wonder, et cetera. They're going to hit the new stuff, Kodak Black, et cetera. They're going to have the palms and the dancers doing backflips, jumping around, the drum majors out there gyrating on the grass. It's going to be an amazing show. They're going to be two schools battling right there at the 50-yard line, going at it. If you've ever seen Drumline, it's that times 10. I thought that movie was a great representation of HBCUs, but I didn't really know until I got to one. And, man, let me tell you, it's the greatest thing.
Just
it's
not
something
the sequel.
About – I'm sorry, go ahead.
Remember the sequel, Drumline 2, I think?
No, not never watch it. Yeah. Never, 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 never will watch it.
I regretted watching
let me
it.
Tell...
and I only saw 20
Barry,
minutes.
Let me tell you. No, no, I will never do it.
Don't do it.
Let
Don't
me
do
tell
that
you
to
something,
your soul.
Barry, it's something about being at a school, and especially for people coming from the inner city, and I mean really coming from the inner city, going to an institute of higher education where the people around you are all thriving to do better, and the people that are teaching you and helping you are all people like you. And I don't mean just black. I mean Hispanic. I mean Cuban. I mean Asian. I mean Jamaican. I mean Bahamian. I mean whatever culture, you know, Nigerian, whatever culture you can think of, whatever ethnicity, whatever race, you know, you got the Muslim Association, the Muslim Student Association, you got everything. These are all, you know, entities that you get at HBCUs. You got a professor, you know, it was so amazing to me to say, hey, I want to be a sports journalist, and to have a guy like Milton Kent who covered the Bullets into their transition to the Wizards, who covered, you know, the entire Cal Ripken era, you know, to have a guy, to have a woman like E.R. Shipp, a Pulitzer Prize winner, a woman that said, hey, I want to send you to the Democratic Convention when you get there in Philly in 2016. When you get there, I want you to go to West Philly. And I'm going to give you Jesse Jackson's number. I want you to interview him. I'm going to tell him that you're coming. You know, that was an experience that I got at an HBCU. I have Jesse Jackson's number in my phone. I have Dick Gregory's number in my phone. I've been to Dick Gregory's house in Baltimore and in D.C. before he died.
Rest in peace to my ancestor.
You know, rest in peace to a great comedian, a great civil rights leader, a great person of color. These are experiences that I got in HBCU. It was life changing. You know, it was, you know, there was, oh man, there was so many moments that I had to sit back and just like, wow. I remember my sophomore year, I was at homecoming, and Morgan does homecoming up, you know. I was at homecoming, and, you know, the alumni and the different fraternities, the big brothers and big sisters, they throw, you know, all over the campus. It's 27 million cookouts going on. And we have, you know, this, you know, hall, lecture hall, and it's been turned into a party. And I was getting my plate. I'm making my plate. I got a burger. I got ribs. I got corn in the cob. I got baked beans, et cetera. I'm making my plate. And, you know, the DJ is spinning SWV's Anything remixed with Wu-Tang from the Above the Rim soundtrack.
Oh, my God.
And it's people, you know, it's people that are like 18, 28, 38, 48, 58, all black. Partying, networking, et cetera, having fun. I'm just sitting there looking around like, man, This is what I watched on A Different World. This is what I watched on Drumline. This is everything that I wanted my high school to be. Everything is right here, and I'm loving it. And I really appreciated my time at Morgan. And let me tell you, once I got into the spirit of being at HBCU and loving my HBCU, I traveled to all of the HBCUs on the East Coast. I get up with the guys and, take a road trip to Virginia State, take a road trip to Norfolk, take a road trip 16 hours down to Spelman and Morehouse, And that's the thing about this area. People branch off after high school and they go to so many different schools, HBCUs, that you got somebody everywhere. I had a friend, I said, listen, I'm coming down, man. It's all good. Come down. I got a bed for you. We got blow up mattresses. Let's go have some fun. So I've been to so many HBCUs. Great experience. I love it. And I hope that I can do a good enough job as a parent one day to say, to influence my child to say, this is what I want to do and keep this tradition going. Because it is a tradition that so many of my friends have, because PG County and DC are two affluent areas in a sense. PG County is one of the most affluent, predominantly black areas, if not the most affluent in the country. So, I do have friends that grew up poor and, had to overcome circumstances. But in the same token, I have friends that have a mom that's a doctor and a dad that's a lawyer. And they both went to Howard. They both went to Hampton. They both went to Southern. They both went to Grambling. They both went to, wherever, Tennessee State, whatever, And now they're passing that tradition on. I got a friend who his parents, both of them went to FAMU down in Florida. And he kind of went against the grain and came to Morgan. But, he's like the only person in his entire immediate family to not go to FAMU, So this is a tradition that I want to pass on to my kids, and my grandkids, because it's been passed on. It's a beautiful, man, it's a beautiful thing. It's I'm all for everyone getting an education and finding out what their niche is and, having the experience. I want to just say this. I want to say that college is not for everybody, but I would like everyone to get the college experience. High school is nothing like it. It is nothing like it. And I had that experience at an HBCU, and it was the greatest thing on earth. I love it. I love it. I love it.
I was a JUCO transfer, and actually in high school I thought about Morehouse, but I kind of backed out at the last second. I was like, nah. And then JUCO, I was like, I could actually transfer to Morehouse now. Like, this could happen. But I was like, nah, my mom won't let me leave the state. I already know it. She's like, nah, it's too far. Because she went to Grambling, but on a track scholarship and everything else, she pulled back. But she eventually, she told me, she was like, it was amazing. Like, the atmosphere, like, at a black college. I never have had I might change my mind for grad school, but, like, that was kind of one of the things I keep hearing from everyone is that HBCUs, like, it's an experience like no other. And when you talk about the bands, I think of, like, Ohio State dotting the I, and they try to, like, when they do cutaways, on TV, and they try to make it seem like, oh, the legendary Ohio State band. I was like, bro, HBCU bands will mop the floor with most PWI bands. But we just, right. Like, no one, we just act like, I'm pretty sure none of those PWI schools can do what, the HBCU schools could do. Because I'm like, some of the greatest musicians ever, let's be honest, black. Mm-hmm. Jazz players. Mm-hmm. Black people invented jazz. So if we're going back to, okay.
And rock and roll.
Exactly. Definitely rock and roll. And I mean, like, black people invented rock and roll. White people killed it. Black people invented hip hop. White people are killing it. Yeah. That's another sad story for another day. But anyway, to kind of talk about, we talked about the lifestyle and all that. Football. Now, yeah. This is kind of a two-parter, but I couldn't, mm-hmm. like, in all due diligence, I couldn't just talk about all the other, players. I'm just going to go straight to it. Amir Hall virtually getting no snaps in the NFL PA Collegiate Bowl. And me thinking back to the last HBCU quarterback that got drafted, Tavares Jackson, and unfortunately he's had some unfortunate situations, domestic violence, things like that, towards that kind of ended his career. But he had a long career in the league. People forget that. With the Vikings, right, they weren't very good when he got drafted there. I felt like he kind of got a raw deal, but I still feel like he was a damn good QB. Now, Amir Hall, you're high on him out of Bowie State. Mm-hmm. Kind of just, you know, lay your analysis of him as a player, what you've seen, and, you know, we'll get into some of the comparisons.
All right. So, you know, the thing about Amir Hall is that, he's right in my backyard. Bowie is 10 minutes away. And that means he's also 10 minutes away from the Redskins. And Doug Williams is VP over there. And you saw what his pull was last year when he said, listen, I'm getting two of my guys. He got Grambling running back.
Martez
Carter? And Martez Carter, and as well as Southern cornerback Danny Johnson. You know, so,
for Danny Johnson.
You know, and then they had Chris Baker. You know, they've had their fair share. Amir Hall, the thing about Amir Hall, if nothing else, Amir Hall is 6'4". And I don't mean that to simplify this, but what I'm saying is that, listen, this is a black 6'4", pass-first quarterback. I've seen this guy. You know, he has a great sense for pressure. And he will stand there and take the hit for the sake of the throw. You know, so that's the first thing in terms of like the, you know, killing the stereotype. This is a pocket passer. You know what I'm saying? This guy is good, you know. So Amir Hall is like, he's not a top five quarterback in this draft, in a weak draft class.
I'm about to say, now, I could argue Drew Lock.
Yeah, well, I'm not. Listen, I'm not even counting Drew Lock. I'm not even counting him. But this is the thing. I'm really against the whole competition thing for HBCU guys. That a lot of people like to kick with the whole level of competition thing. But I think that the critique for Amir Hall is that he dominated his conference so bad. That's gonna be the case for most people. Like, this guy is the number five passer in the nation. FCS, FBS, Division I, Division II, Division III. You know, so it's like he was so good that it's like, well, what the hell is going on in the FCS? You know, in what would be considered the CIAA conference. Amir Hall is comparable, you know, Tavares Jackson would be a lazy comparison in a sense. I'll give you a white quarterback to compare him to. Not so much in terms of size, but in terms of intelligence, in terms of the way he plays the game. And that would be, I would say, kind of like a mix between Marcus Mariota and Alex Smith in the sense that he can run, you know, more so leaning towards Mariota. He can take off. But he's going to give you great short to intermediate throws. You know, he's very aware of what's going on in the field. He can read the defense well. Now, deep ball, he can throw the deep ball, but will he? Not much. But, you know, that was kind of like how Bowie State designed the offense for him. So it'll be interesting to see where he lands at the next level, you know, in terms of what they're asking him to do. But Bowie State, he had so many weapons in terms of the short game where, you know, he's checking down and throwing bubbles and these guys are taking it 75 yards. So it's like, it's you know, from what I've seen from him, this is a great game manager is what I'm getting at. He's a great game manager. He's a very smart player. He's a very smart player. You know, so it's like, I really like, you know, I really like what his skill set offers. This guy, you know, I kind of like had to, you know, kind of go on a rant about him because it's like, I feel like he felt that, hey, I have to, get away from the stereotypical quarterback notions of the black quarterback. So it's like, this guy ran for 2 touchdowns last year. You know, and he started, in his sophomore year, he ran for 8. He ran for 2 touchdowns this year. He doesn't really run the ball like that. You know, he'll throw the ball away or take the sack or, you know, stand in there and take a hit. If he, you know, he's waiting for that read to develop. You know, I really like his skill set. I think that depending on where he falls, you know, the system that he lands in is where the development comes. He has a tendency to, you know, as smart as he has a tendency to kind of, push the ball towards who he wants to throw it to in situations of like 3rd down, which is really bad for a quarterback, which we see a lot of times with guys like Jameis Winston or whatever, you know, in those situations where it's like you need to convert. And it's like, okay, well, I know I want to hit this tight end on a drag, and he'll force it in there. He doesn't throw many interceptions. That's the thing. But it's like I'm kind of nitpicking, but I'm not, because he won't be able to do that at the pro level is my point. Yeah. You know, so it's like you have to curb that now. Like, you can't look down this tight end on 3rd and 3, you know, and throw to that drag, because, you know, you're nearly throwing picks at this level. You're not going to be able to do that against a guy like Chris Harris, you know, against a smart linebacker. You know, so this is going to be an issue. So, you know, he's not flawless, but he's certainly the best black quarterback from an HBCU since Tavares Jackson. He's the best prospect. This is the guy that's like, okay, there, you know, you can't give me the same arguments that you've given the guys over the last 12 years, whoever that it is that we've thrown out there. This is this guy. He eclipses them all, you know?
Yeah, because I don't think he's athletic or as fast as Tavares, and he probably doesn't have a rocket for an arm like Tavares, but he probably is more accurate. And touch can be an issue, but I think with him, he could probably actually gain some more weight. He looks.
Yeah, he has to.
Yeah, because I saw, I think he had like an 80-yard touchdown run in the title game or something like that. So he's mobile, but my bigger point with the Amir Hall snub, because like Pete, he was there. He was like, he mostly just got handoffs. He might be able to run a read option. I think like he would be a perfect backup to Patrick Mahomes or Aaron Rodgers. Like in a system like that. That would be good for him. Not somewhere like, oh, let's put you in Tennessee behind Mariota in a broken system. Or let's even New England. I would be shocked if he ended up in New England. But I think just when it comes to HBCU players, and you see so many, like Tariq Cohen, and you said this, I remember when he was on like Sports Nation and he had to do the flip to catch all the balls. And I was like, okay, he's an explosive great athlete. Like he can play. But it's weird how we can stigmatize HBCUs when the best football players are predominantly black, because the NFL is predominantly black. It's a weird kind of like burning the candle at both ends. And I just.
And Barry, you can take that a level further. It's weird that we stereotype HBCUs when you really can make a case that most of the greatest NFL players came from HBCUs. Jerry Rice, without a question.
Aeneas Williams, you know, that's one. Sweetness.
Aeneas Williams, Sweetness. I mean, you can go, you can take it to the Raiders.
The dudes who make the Hall of Fame this year. Yeah.
You know, Michael Strahan, you know, Shannon Sharp. You can make the case he's one of the greatest, if not the greatest tight end, depending on who you ask. You know, so
I don't know why people say
it's a lot of ways that you can it's a lot of ways you can take it in terms of this argument. Like I said, aside from the quarterback position, I've said this before. Aside from the quarterback position, you can make a case that an HBCU player is the best player at every other position. Okay, quarterback, kicker, and punter. That's it. Everything else, you can make a case that the best player of all time at every position was an HBCU player. Every one of them.
True. It's fair. And the reason why you probably wouldn't say quarterback is because of the racial stigma that goes with that black men aren't intelligent in society.
Yep.
That's why I'm like, I look at Cam Newton's little brother when they beat UNLV at Howard. The kid can play. Mm-hmm. It'll be interesting to see if he gets, you know, kind of jilted the way I think, I don't know, they probably won't be like, eh, he's Cam Newton's, you know, lesser brother. And Pete, of course, Jackie Slater, because, you know, Pete just, Pete loves Jackie Slater. It's true. I think you said it, you tweeted a while back, your HBCU has more Hall of Famers than, like, Mountain West teams, like Boise State, Colorado.
We can definitely get into that argument. I was telling somebody, I've tweeted multiple times, there are several HBCUs that have more. This is the thing. Let's take Morgan State. Let's take Grambling. Let's take Jackson State.
That's a lot already.
Let's take those three. Take those three and add, say, let's say Grambling, Morgan, Jackson State. Let's say add FAMU or like I'm trying to think. I would say, you know, FAMU, maybe Southern. You take those five schools. I'm about to pull up the actual tweet, because if you take 4 to 5 HBCUs or the best HBCUs, these HBCUs have more Hall of Famers than every other conference besides the SEC and the ACC. Every other one, period.
Oh, yeah, that was the tweet that was crazy. I remember that tweet. The Pac-12. Think about that.
Yeah.
I mean,
the thing is, this is like, and this is not, you know, people are like, oh, that's from the 60s up. No, it's not. Aeneas Williams, Michael Strahan. These are recent players. And then you got guys like Tariq Cohen and Darius. Darius Leonard has Hall of Fame potential. You know, so it's like,
you were a big champion
in
him.
Relevant.
Last year, you were a big champion in him coming out of South Carolina State.
Yeah.
I was like, yeah.
I mean, because it was like, I was like, man, this guy is good. And the crazy thing is, the guy that I'm champion for this year actually beat out Leonard last year for the SWAC Defensive Player of the Year.
The Christmas dude? Is that his last name?
Yes, yes.
Not the Florida State guy, the other one.
Back-to-back, Grambling, yeah. He's the first back-to-back Defensive Player of the Year in like 30-something years. He beat out Leonard last year. He's an inch smaller than him. But he's really good, and he's not getting any attention at all.
Did he even get invited to the Senior Bowl?
No, he did not. Senior, collegiate, or Shrine. Nope. Not any of them.
Do you feel like that's kind of...
Yeah.
I know it's kind of changed with, like, more guys getting Shrine, more HBCU guys actually getting in at these, you know, the lowest level type of all-star games. And I've seen it even on the high school level. I had a teammate who was our best running back that my high school head coach at the time was the head coach for the All-Star game, the Lions All-Star game in like 2010. And our starting running back got no play time. I was like, that's kind of weird. He was your best running back for 3 years and you didn't play him at all in an All-Star game. Like, that doesn't really help. But I mean, when I look at HBCU players and I see, okay, it's not a gimmicky offense most of the time that they're in. They just put up gaudy numbers or excel. And people, like, for some, I think the star system is what kind of almost put a nail in the coffin for HBCUs.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you took away stars and just put on tape, a lot of cats who are considered five stars, probably, like, who don't even end up playing at a D1 school, they transfer 5 times and they have like one good season, and then they go down to D2 and they're not good either. Like,
yeah,
I think that would also change the landscape. But
well, there's so many things I think. There's so many things I think will change the landscape. Now, you know, we have, you know, like you said, the star system, and then over that, it's like nowadays social media. Social media plays a big part. I feel like in a 17-year-old's mind, it's like the difference of saying, hey, I'm going to put on Instagram that I'm going to Tennessee or Florida State compared to Morgan State, who's telling me, like, listen, you come here, you're going to start immediately. And Florida State is like, well, I'm probably going to be fifth on the depth chart, you know? And that's how players wash out and end up at these schools. You know, this is the thing, Barry. I don't even want, I don't want people to say, hey, this guy wants HBCU players to be considered before Alabama players. No, I want a fair shot. I want these guys to have a fair shot. I want everybody to have the benefit of the doubt. You know, we've seen, and I point this out because it's true. Last year, Eric Saubert, the tight end, was so sought after at draft season right now, you know, draft, like we like to call draft season. This guy came from Drake. You know, when the hell was the last time you heard of a football player from Drake? You know, and people are scrambling and, you know, squinting their eyes trying to watch this damn tape from Drake University. It's all
definitely
a basketball school. You know, VHS looking. You know, and people are like, hey, you know, I can't find any HBCU tape. Blah, blah, blah. I'm like, dude, you just watched Eric Saubert. Where the hell did this guy come from? You know, so it's like, get these guys the benefit of the doubt too. Even with the Senior Bowl thing and all that. It's like, you know, you got Titus Howard there, who's a HBCU guy from Alabama State. This kid was a damn quarterback. He was 200 pounds. He's 311 pounds right now. It's like, you know, everybody's like, oh, Titus Howard, he's going to be drafted. You know, it's like, even with that, it's like, you got Howard there, but then every day at the Senior Bowl, you're hearing about some guy from, like, Wichita Valley State College.
Or and it's Arkansas like four Pine Bluff.
Fuckers there. You know, so it's like, if you're giving these guys, you know, these no-name schools, three and four guys, give the HBCUs two. You know, so it's like North Carolina A&T right now. They got a 6'4 quarterback of their own that's entering the draft, Lamar Rayner. You know, he's like one of the best MEAC quarterbacks over the last few years. He's not getting any love. Then you got Daryl Johnson, who was MEAC Defensive Player of the Year, averaging like 9 sacks a year. He declared early this year. He's a FCS legend. And he didn't get an invite to the Senior Bowl. He didn't even get a late invite to the Senior Bowl. You got guys getting invited to the Senior Bowl today. You know, they're like late roster replacements. So it's like, come on. Get these guys a shot, you know? You got Josh Allen. You got all these guys that dropped out of the Senior Bowl. But you can't give Daryl Johnson a shot. Like I said, all he asked for is a shot. You know, there are guys there at the Senior Bowl that had the name and they were hyped up and they looked bad. It's competition. That's what happens. Somebody has to lose. So I'm not saying that these HBCU guys will go there and all of them are going to dominate. All of them are going to be Tariq Cohen. But you got to give them the chance to fail or succeed is what I'm saying. And I have to give people that exposure to this because it's something that means something to me and it means something to a lot of people. And it should mean something to the next generation, but we have to make it mean something. I cannot tell, and I work with kids. I'm working with a team right now, you know, coaching with a friend. I cannot tell these high school kids to go to Morgan State if they don't see the value of Morgan State, Barry. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, you know, if this kid, Joshua Miles, get drafted, that's going to be another kid where they're like, you know, Morgan go to the NFL, you know. And with the more players that get drafted, that's the more players that have money to give that money back to these schools to make their facilities better, et cetera. That's how you have these schools, you know. That's how these mega schools got to where they are. You know, so it's like you got boosters and everything.
Good PR,
too. You have these HBCUs. Yeah, great. You know, so it's like you said at the beginning of the conversation. That's the question. That's the situation, hypothetical situation that everybody says. You know, if you got, you know, the top 100, well, top 300, ESPN top 300. If the 30 of the top 300 went to HBCU, the dynamic would change immediately. Like, I was really, 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 really hoping that the 2019 top defensive end in this class, Kayvon Thibodeau, went to FAMU. And he had FAMU on his list. He went on a visit and everything. You know, he ultimately chose Oregon, but that would have been the start of a serious conversation. You cannot put this kid as the number one defensive end in the class and then say he's sorry because he went to FAMU. Because
he actually,
you have to put them on ESPN, you know?
He was at
Dorsey.
You have
to show people those games.
He was at Dorsey High School when he transferred to Oaks Christian. And that's my beef with, like, they're finally putting together a transfer council committee in California. But it's like so many kids are transferring. Like, I look at IMG, which is like a private high school. Like, what about these high schools, these military academies? Like, they're plucking talent from everywhere. I think of, and I've been using this hashtag a lot, hashtag Raiders passed on him. And this dude was on my list. He's the left tackle for the Saints. Like Teron Armstead?
Teron Armstead, yeah.
Dude ran like a 4.5 or 4.6 as a left tackle.
Yeah, he ran a 4.67, excuse me, I'm sorry.
Yeah, and like was a functionally good talent. Like he had talent. I was like, he would have been worth drafting. I mean, I still hate the Brandon. I will always hate the Brandon Parker pick. I think it was a waste of a pick, and they're probably going to end up taking a tackle this year. But whatever.
I want to say, I want to put the disclaimer out. I'm very happy that Brandon Parker got drafted. I wrote about him. I wrote about why the Raiders should draft him. I don't think anybody else anticipated Brandon Parker having a start. He wasn't ready. I didn't think he was ready. I thought he was going to be a nice developmental project, a nice swing tackle until he got ready. He got through to the fire, and all of his flaws were, you know, out there in the open, and people took advantage of it. Teams took advantage of it. I can't blame him.
I wouldn't have made him a third-round pick,
though. All he can do now is get better.
Yeah. I would have made him like a fifth-round pick, but like third round when like Jerome Baker – linebackers who can cover and are fast, Malik Jefferson, over at a BYU, like cats were on the board. Fred Warner, that was his name.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Fred Warner, yeah.
So it's like it's
who had a good rookie year.
Yeah. All those cats, except I think Jefferson was the only one who didn't really start much, but
Bernard Avery was the guy that was like, God damn it.
I'm so mad that they passed on him. I was like, he can play edge and he can play middle linebacker and he can play defensive, like, and they passed on him. It's just this guy. Like, I have the list of like all the players they pass on, and I'm just like, why? How do you not draft? You draft through the line, through defense. You're out of a franchise quarterback. You build around that, and the Raiders are incompetent. Like, is Reggie Nelson still on the roster? By the way, is he a coach? Like,
yes, he is.
Leon Hall. Because like I one day there's gonna be. I feel like I already talked to Pete. There's gonna be a 30 for 30 on the University of Florida. And I feel like it's going to make Tebow look bad. But I just don't understand how and why he is still on an NFL roster.
Man. Reggie Nelson is pretty hilarious. Like, that situation is really bad. It's like...
He plays like Screwface.
they really need to address that position this year. Like, seriously. It's going on too long.
And a name that you talking about, and that's kind of popped up a lot, Nasir Adderley out of Delaware.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
yes.
When it comes to, like, there's some pretty good prospects in this game. I feel like Amon Marshall, the corner at USC, I feel like he should probably convert to safety. But for pound, when it comes to just press coverage and all that, and he really was one of the best corners in football his senior year. Because, yeah, he didn't get a lot of picks, but he, as far as yards per reception by receivers, it was practically almost zero. So I see a lot of depth. I look at Avante Maddox, the corner for the Eagles that they got last year, who ran like a 4.39 out of Pittsburgh. It was really good. Where do you see, you know, whether it's Senior Bowl, All-Star games, like where do you see some kind of late-round prospects? HBCU or not?
Late round. Man, let me say, this draft is kind of top heavy. It's like, you know, last year I was all in seven rounds. I'm like, this is the guy. This year, it's like, after like round five, I'm like, I don't know.
Taking chances.
But with that being said, I think this is, you know, as weak as it is overall, I think defensively, there are some steals. I was actually looking at a few guys. Now, one that stuck out to me, I was just actually talking to my co-host T. Biggs about him, was Evan Worthington, the safety from Colorado. I actually like him. I think he's going to be a nice day three addition to some team. I think the Raiders should look at him, you know, because I do think that Reggie Nelson and Eric Harris aren't going to cut it. You know, so in terms of the linebacker position, this is another year that the Raiders have to address the linebacker position in terms of finding guys that can cover with some speed. You know, and luckily there are some guys in this draft with speed and, you know, pretty decent coverage ability.
Mac Wilson.
But I think that in terms of late, I think a guy would be that I would be interested in is Bobby Okereke. A few other guys, Patty Fisher. There are a few guys in this draft at the linebacker position, I'd say, you know, they're kind of Gruden guys, and they would, you know, be good contributors. Now, if you look at the base of what the linebacker group is, I've advocated for them. I think that a good starter piece would be Nicholas Morrow. Not really a fan of Kabinda. Not really a fan of Tahir Whitehead at all.
Facts.
But, you know, so I think that understanding like that this game is only speeding up, you have to get fast guys. You have to get fast guys. The game is speeding up. You know, you got to have some dual threats in there. And there are a few dual threat linebackers in this draft. Other than that, defensive line is like another position that's like, I feel like it's really, really deep. I think I have like maybe 15 defensive ends and defensive tackles going in round one, but I think I kind of spread that out through the draft, you know, and you got a guy like Gerald Willis, who for all the trouble that he's had in his past, you know, as good as he is, he's not going to go in the first round. He might not go in the second, you know, so.
You could be a steal in the third.
Yeah. And then you have a guy that I really like from the show Last Chance U, Ronald Ollie. You know, he's going to be a late steal, you know, at the defensive tackle position. And there's a lot of guys in the draft that I felt like, you know, late, somebody's going to get a gem. Mm.
So, also, before we wrap it up, Deontay Thompson, a guy that you kind of clowned on Twitter, based off, you know, that Alabama beat, they got beat down by Clemson, that national title game. And that infamous, like, 75-yard touchdown catch where the corner, I guess, ruptured his Achilles tendon, whatever, falls. And he just totally whiffs. Where do you see the Raiders going with those three first-round picks?
Oh, wow. I feel like I've answered this question so many times, you know, in terms of my own mind or as well as other people. And I think that as of today, let me say this. I'm sticking to this notion. I do think that the Raiders will address the defensive end edge rusher position in free agency. When you got money, you got to spend it. You got guys like Frank Clark, Jadeveon Clowney, et cetera, in free agency. You got to get one of those guys.
You cannot go into
another season with two rookies or a rookie and Arden Key on the opposite side. Can't do it. Not be successful. So with that being said, at the fourth pick, I'm going to go with my guy, Greedy Williams. I feel like I desperately want to see the Raiders have a lockdown corner on both sides of the ball. The 24th pick, I think that I'm operating under the premise that I'm a franchise Jared Cook, and I want to secure my tight end position for the future. I'm not going to do that at the 24th pick. 24th pick, I'm going to take I'm going to take Nazir Adderley because I want to get Reggie Nelson off the field. I want to send him back to wherever he came from. And I like the combination of that young, fast combination of Adderley and Carl Joseph with Eric Harris and sub passes, you know. I'll do you one more. I like the idea of moving Nick Nelson to safety. So
Because he really in the corner.
I like that group. I really like that group right there. A young group to grow. At 27 pick, I thought, you know, three picks is not really that much of a difference, but it is in this situation. I'm looking at Noah Fant being gone in the top 20, as well as Irv Smith. And I'm going to get the guy that I feel like is a Gruden guy. I feel like that is the best pass blocking tight end in this draft, the best run blocking tight end in this draft. And he's pretty good receiving tight end. And that's TJ Hockenson from Iowa. And right there, you know, having the guy that not only Jared Cook, but also that Lee Smith can mentor and get something out of him immediately. Another playmaker on the field, high motor guy. But I'm also addressing the defense in two key positions. And I'm not reaching for Quinnen Williams, even though that if he's there, that's a hard choice because I think the best player available at four is between Williams and Williams. So it's like it's kind of dependent on free agency and what you're looking at with the defensive line of what you already have. And I'm operating under the notion that at 35, the 35 pick, I'm going to take another edge rusher. So I'm looking at a Zach Allen. I'm looking at a Carl Granderson. I'm looking at one of those Chase Winovich, one of those type of guys. So
Jalen Ferguson,
that's how I'm looking at it right now.
Mm-hmm. So interesting, you didn't say wide receiver. No Deion Butler. So he's too dangerous.
I'm kind of nervous about. I'm kind of nervous about this wide receiver group. It's either for me edge rusher or wide receiver at 35. But I am operating under the premise that I truly, truly believe that it will be no more than one wide receiver taken in the first round. I think everybody's going to, like, go off in the second with the receivers. And I think that, in my mind, if I'm going to take anybody in the second round, I'm going to look at the fact that I personally want to get Jordy Nelson the hell off the field. So I'm looking at an outside receiver. I'm looking at somebody with some decent size. I'm looking at a guy like DK Metcalf, who I think the only thing that could keep him from going out of the first round is fear of his neck injury. And I feel like he's the best receiver in this draft. And I think a close second right now, especially after the performance that he's putting on at the Senior Bowl, is Deebo Samuel. That's another guy I'm looking at. Third is the splash guy that everybody wants. I think he's too small, and that's Hollywood Brown. I don't care if he's Antonio Brown's cousin. He's really little. And, you know, so those two receivers would be the two guys that I'm considering at 35. They're there. Maybe Calvin Harmon as well.
Okay. All right.
Or N'Keal Harry. One of those four. I don't think any of those guys deserve to go in the top. I mean, in the first round, unless Harry gets a great, clean bill of health.
Because I feel like Harry moves like a little guy. He's fluid, he's athletic, and he actually put up numbers with a trash quarterback. So I feel like it could be
a terrible quarterback.
A Keenan Allen situation, except Manny Wilkins wasn't as bad as Zach Maynard at Cal.
Mm.
But one last thing, and then we'll kind of wrap it up. What did you think of Tyree Jackson? 6'7" out of Buffalo. Is he Josh Freeman all over again, or is he a little bit better? What do you think he is?
Josh Freeman is a good I was actually looking at a couple people comparing him to Josh Allen, and
he's a better passer
really
than Josh
agree
Allen.
With that. I can see where you get that from, but I didn't really agree with that one. I was trying to think of somebody. I like that Josh Freeman comp, but I think he's going to be a little bit better than Josh Freeman. I think he's going to be a little bit better than Josh Freeman. So I think that he's a project. I think that he's a good developmental. This is a crazy draft where you have, you know, you're going to have three black, maybe four or five black quarterbacks over 6'5", and none of them are really run-first quarterbacks. You have so many styles of quarterback in this draft And so many of them need to be developed. You got a guy like Gardner Minshew, who I feel like is going to be one of the best backups ever.
Exactly. Billy Volek.
It's really weird. I think that Tyree is going to be a little bit better than Josh Freeman. I think that it all depends on the system that he goes to. I'm really scared for a lot of these guys. Like, I don't want to see him end up in Denver just like rotting. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I don't even think Denver would take him that high. I think they would, you know, Elway is going to take a guy that he feels more secure about, like Drew Locke, who I think that, in my opinion, I think that Locke is like, at his ceiling is like 2016 Derek Carr, and his floor is like 2017 Derek Carr. It's like, he's so much like Derek Carr to me. It's like, it's crazy. You know what I'm saying? It's like, the confident Derek Carr that we saw in 2016, that's him, like, on a good day, on a good game. Mm. And then, like, when it's bad, it's, like, really bad. It's like Derek Carr bad, but, like, a little bit worse. Like,
yeah, I feel it.
Man, it's like, I think that he has extreme potential, but when he plays bad, it's bad.
Yeah, he's stunk it up with some games in Missouri. And I think they lost their bowl game, too. But, thank you for coming on, man. This was one of the probably most informative interviews I've ever had the pleasure of doing in my life. I've learned so much about Go-Go. And I hope you adapt this book into a screenplay. Like, you could flip it. You could pitch it.
I'm actually working on it, man.
Hey.
I'm actually working on it.
That's what's up.
I'm really appreciative, and I'm thankful to be on this show tonight, guys. And Barry, I thank you for having me on. Such, you asked some great questions. And, you know, when you get asked a great question, you got to give a great answer. You got to elaborate and give well thought out answers. So
appreciate
I'm really
you.
Happy to be on tonight. I'm very grateful. So, you know, hopefully you guys will bring me back before the draft.
Open door policy,
talk about
bro.
This some more.
Open door policy. You can call it every week for the rest of whenever if you want to. It's all good. But, man, shout out, you know, shout your socials out. Where they can find you, where you can get the book, all that.
I want to shout out first and foremost my Twitter, which is OBEE, the number one NE. Give me a follow, man. I talk to everybody. I talk about everything. The book is called Bounce Me Baby. Again, it can be found on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and iTunes, you know? So, with that being said, I want to also give a shout out to, you know, this is the FPC family. I want to give a shout out to my co-host T-Biggs. Check us out every Tuesday on the Black Tuesday podcast on iTunes and SoundCloud as well. So
big facts.
I want to thank you guys tonight for having me on tonight, and make sure everybody, I know if you're tuning in right now, you know, listen to this, please every week, listen to this show, because Barry just, you know, ask some upper echelon questions, man. I'm very happy to be on, man. It was a great experience.
Thank you. I had to dig deep for this one. It felt right. This felt like, like as much go-go as you talk, I was like, yeah, I can't come half prepared. Like this, nah, this felt like a Super Bowl, except, you know, we actually care who wins. By the way, who are you picking in the Super Bowl? Last thing, I swear.
Patriots. I just think that, you
how
know,
dare
as,
you?
As much as, you know, as much as a, you know, smart mind that McVay is, you know, bruh, I can't see him being the old man. I think that McVay has shown some weaknesses. This is the thing, man. I think Bill Belichick is so good at finding the weakness in people, and he exploits it to a T. Andy Reid has so much talent on the other side of that field, and there were so many chances for the Chiefs to win that game. But Andy Reid did an Andy Reid thing. He's terrible at managing the clock. And you know, I thought that Belichick tried to call the bluff, and he called him on it. You know, that last drive, there's no way that the Chiefs should have been on that drive. I think it was like 13 plays. It's like, come on, man. You got to call a timeout at some point. There was some, and then Andy Reid, he was scared to take the, you know, I understand why he didn't take the chance with 11 seconds left to throw another pass, but I thought that he should have. I thought that
this is not Alex Smith. This is not Trent Green. This is not any of those guys in the past. You got Mahomes. Give him a chance to win the game for you at home. This is the most pivotal game you're going to that you played in, what, 40 years? Take the chance. You got the field goal. You went to overtime and lost. You had time to take one more chance and play with second down. I thought that Belichick outsmarted him in this game. And Andy Reid is a vet. McVay is very young. But all the time that he got, once you get past that first level, that defensive line, that the rest of that defense is like, you know,
trash.
They make mistakes. I don't want to say that, but yeah, they make mistakes. And let me tell you, Belichick is going to pick on Marcus Peters, and I think that he rightfully should.
It might be bad. Yeah, shout out to my Oakland brother and Marcus Peters. But thanks again.
I think that if nothing else, wait. I'm sorry. I gotta say this.
Go ahead.
You don't have to go off against Marcus Peters. But if you get in his head, if you get in Tlaib's head, that changes the game, you know. So we're going to see how this works, you know. But I'm pretty confident in the Patriots winning. I don't want them to win, but I'm being a realist, you know. So I think the Patriots will win this game.
They lead decidedly, the league.
Decidedly.
Ouch. They lead the league in white privilege, but they're also really well coached.
I think it's going to be a 2-touchdown deficit.
Damn, okay. As a Rams fan, like, I can't let you keep doing this, Obi. It's painful. You can't kill me with the Raiders and the Rams in my lifetime.
It's nothing personal, but I'm being, man, listen.
It hurts.
Like, I tweeted, man. I said, man, people want Belichick to lose, Brady to lose so bad, and they know deep down inside it won't happen. We've gotten to that point. It's just like when... It's just like when Mayweather was, like, trying so hard to get the 49-0, and people are like, yeah, Andre Berto is going to beat Floyd Mayweather. Like, come on, dog.
Come on, bro. Andre
Berto. Like, bro, this midget is not going to beat Mayweather, bro.
Wow.
People wanted Pacquiao to beat Mayweather, and they knew it wouldn't happen. They thought that, like, there were people that convinced themselves that Floyd Mayweather was going to stand there and box with Manny Pacquiao. And then they said, oh, Floyd Brand, come on, man. At some point, you got to be real about stuff. It doesn't have to be what you want it to be, but you got to know what the truth is. And at this point, I feel like that the only thing that's going to stop this Patriots dynasty is the Patriots. We've seen so many instances of these little inside stories and stuff. When their time is up, it's really going to be up. The Patriots organization is going to suck for a long time after this thing is over. But right now, it's not over.
I hope they get hot pockets at the White House. Anyway, man, thanks for calling in again. Shout out your Twitter handle one more time.
It is OBEE, the number 1NE, and I will certainly be back.
Definitely. Salute. Have a good night, man. Thanks for staying up this late.
All right, man. Thank you. Have a good one.
Peace.
Peace.
Whew, man. Let's just... That was a moment in time right there. It got kind of slow, you know, at the end on the analysis part, but that's just football. But man... Yeah, definitely get Obi's book. Definitely hope y'all learned something about Go-Go tonight. And, you know, stop shitting on Wale, personally. I'm tired of y'all talking bad on Wale's name. And, yeah, J. Cole slandered Wale a while back, but it's cool because they're friends. But anyway, I'm going to get on to some news real quick. Pete said Hot Pockets in the White House is the new title. Yes, it is. I was going to say only the middle child gets Hot Pockets, but whatever. Anyway, so just a couple of things. Larry Fitzgerald is coming back for his 18th. No, I'm just kidding. It's like his 16th year, I think. He's already top 5 in catches, yards, touchdowns. So he's pretty much a Hall of Famer whenever he retires. And he's going to give it one more good old try in Arizona, I guess. If it doesn't work out, for. I really wish Larry Fitzgerald would have asked for a trade to like the Patriots or the Packers or somewhere, but leave Arizona, please. You're never gonna win there. You were never. If they couldn't beat the Steelers in that game, it was never going to happen. You haven't heard Steve Breston's name since that game. Like, I don't even remember what year of Madden he's on. Like, it's been that far along. It's crazy. But first off, Pete, I jokingly talked bad about Wale, but I love Wale's music. I fight you. And I put you on Amigos, so don't you ever forget that. By the way, their song Pure Waters is dope. It's fire. But all right, so another thing that's going to be happening at the Super Bowl, the Rams will debut their Mayor Chill. The Rams will debut their male cheerleaders at the Super Bowl. All right, another caller. Let's go. Hello, caller. What is your name and where are you calling from? It sounds like you're in the back of a hood Chinese spot getting a turkey or a chicken on like a hook somewhere. Is it raining? What's going on? That's Pete, obviously, but what's going on?
Well, right now I'm at the Laker game. I'm about to head downstairs.
I heard whistling.
Start working on my recap.
Okay, okay. Weird flex, but okay.
But yeah, man. I want to shout out Malik. It was a great interview. I'm going to shout you out, man. That was a great interview. Probably one of the best ones you've ever done.
I know.
Your levels are actually on point.
Yeah, that's what happens when I do my own levels.
You're only 15 minutes late.
I wasn't 15 minutes late.
But yeah, man.
Yeah, I'm glad I heard. Show.
And I'm going to need you to stop all of a sudden, you know, acting like you weren't the authority of hate on Wale.
I was never. No, you are not painting me with that broad brush. Bro, first off, we all know Julius. Was it Julius who hated Wale? What somebody we went
you
to school.
You hated Wale.
No, it was. I did not hate Wale.
You didn't even hate Wale.
I was just like, he's
Wale
bitter.
I liked him.
No, because you said you hated J. Cole, and you literally wrote a hate piece on why Forest Hills Drive was trash, and I honestly think you're not an aficionado of music, and I just haven't respected you since, because that was a great album, and he literally did it with no features.
Now that album was trash. I stand by it.
No, your article was trash on how J. Cole's album was trash. Nah, man. I can't. And then also, I put you on Amigos. And ever since you said that Takeoff was on the spectrum, I just haven't been able to enjoy Migos since. It's your fault. Like, I heard Pure Magic and I was like, Takeoff is the best rapper in Migos, but it doesn't matter because he's probably on the spectrum and now I can't enjoy it. And I hope he's somewhere on the John Wick 3 soundtrack too.
Hey, but one thing I did want to say is, I know you guys are talking about Amir Hall, and you know, I was at the NFLPA game, and
you were
pretty much the only snaps he got were handoffs. So, and like everyone on the Twitterverse, everyone in the press box, you know, he had a good amount of hype, and he didn't even get a chance to succeed. Versus, well, you know, Giants Suns head coach
Shermer
basically played two-thirds of the game.
And Jake Browning
and
was looking trash.
Browning, the white hope of 2016, who we're still waiting to play up to that level.
The right-handed Kellen Moore.
When he had a great defense.
And,
that took him
and,
there,
John,
but,
and John Ross.
But, yeah, he pretty much played two-thirds of the game as well. And honestly, I mean, yeah, he did look a step above the competition. He did look like the only real draftable quarterback, but at the same time, I mean, they kind of typecasted him that, and it became a self-fulfilling prophecy at that point. Outside of that, man, got to talk to my boy Coach Slater. Shout out to him. Got to talk to Xavier Ubosi out of UAB. He caught a couple good passes.
Alabama, Birmingham.
They said he runs a 4.43. That's what Petros is saying.
Did you just quote Petros Papadakis on this podcast?
You used to like Petros.
We all did.
Well, yeah, pretty much. His reporting said that Obosi pretty much Reseda grad, Pierce college transfer. He turned down offers from schools out here, as well as turned down opportunities to go to the Shrine Bowl and the Senior Bowl, which are a little bit bigger.
That's impressive.
To play in front of his hometown.
That's real love.
Because I guess he said this is his first time that he got to play
in California
in the 2 years since he transferred. Yeah.
But I would have definitely went to the Senior Bowl after that All-Star game.
It was a great moment, man, because I was trying to talk to him, and he had about 50 people there. Everyone trying to give him dabs, taking pictures of him. And he's like, hold on, man. I'm sorry. I'm just trying to get to everyone. I was like, don't worry about it, man. It's your moment. Enjoy it.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of, man, he was a good kid. Running back who won MVP, uh-huh. Led Hills from Rolling Rock or Slippery Rock.
Yeah.
Also real cool. He basically, they asked him, what was your highlight of the NFLPA game? Everyone kept asking that because they wanted some sort of answer. But
a magical quote.
Dude pretty much kind of went on a rant and was like, bro, Quentin Portis was my coach. Like, he just kept emphasizing that. He's like, dudes I played man with were my coaches. Ed Reed, like, just seeing Ed Reed in the hotel lobby, like, come on, bro. Like, you can't write that. And so he was just kind of going off on that. Like, I had Josh Cribbs as my special teams coach. Like, you know how many punt returns we take to the house just talking smack?
Especially when you put Josh Cribbs at running back, that's a cheat code.
Yeah, so it was another good kid, man. It was an all-around great experience, a lot of good access. Third year covering it, so really helped me gain some confidence. Which brings me to, of course, the greatest moment of the weekend.
Oh, wait. Oh, when he said this, I didn't believe it, but let's go.
Yeah, man. So there I was.
Teachable moment.
The broadcast. Michael Vick was on the broadcast. So, of course, they have the broadcast playing in the press room. And after the third quarter, he's saying bye. He's like, oh, thanks for being here. And I'm like, I'm going to try to catch this dude at the elevator. So, lo and behold, everything happens for a reason. I'm walking to the elevator, just casually, like, not trying to creep. And who walks out the stairwell from the broadcast floor? None other than the legend, the great Michael Vick. So, there he was, with his Gucci bag and stuff. And I was like, how you doing, sir? And he's like, what's good, man? And I was like, yeah, man, I just got to tell you, I got tremendous respect for you. You know, your story, I supported you through it all, man. It meant a lot to me for you to make it back and stuff like that. And he was like, really, man? You supported it? Yeah, I was like, yeah, I read the book and everything. And he's like, yeah, man, that really means a lot to me. Like, I really appreciate that. And then we pretty much just started talking about the game, started talking about him going kind of his lifestyle right now, working the broadcast booth and stuff like that. But yeah, man, it was just really cool. He's a really, really, really cool dude. He was taking pictures of security, you know. So shout out to him, man.
That's what's up.
One of those moments where it's like, I don't break character often. I've seen a lot of professional athletes in my life. There's few exceptions. Michael Vick is that one.
You bought his shoes, bro.
Yeah.
You bought his shoes and a jersey. I can only imagine how many.
Signed ball.
Yeah, damn.
Yeah. That's
a
Mike Vick fan, bro.
Clearly. You were clearly in the dog pack. That's just amazing,
what's that?
Man. I said you were in the dog pound with him. That's what's up.
Yeah, I was. I took a lot of shit when I was in high school for him.
Pretty sure, yeah. There were fights. There were points of contention when you brought up Michael Vick a while ago. opinion.
But yeah, man, Saturday, I know you had credentials but couldn't make it. But yeah, Saturday for me was just one of those experiences where it's like everything kind of aligned, man. Everything just felt like the universe brought me there.
That's what's up. That's a beautiful thing.
It was a good experience.
So anything else you want to say before I let you go and I kind of wrap things up?
No, man. Just once again, great show. See you next week.
Yep. How you feeling about that that Saints PI call?
Don't get me started on that Saints call, man. I don't know how Madden got that call, right?
But the refs didn't?
The NFL didn't. Even Nickell Robey Coleman said he did PI. That's the worst part.
He's like, yeah, I did it, and I'd do it again. But,
like
during the Super Bowl.
It was blatant. And, like, I don't know. It's kind of Breeze's fault. He should have put more air to the ball.
I think he shouldn't have thrown to Tommy Lee Lewis in that type of situation. I'm looking for Trey Thompson.
Do you think he catches it?
It's kind of like really. It's kind of. I can't really hear you all that much. But you said, do you think he catches it?
Yeah.
I think that was a throwaway play. I don't even think he would have caught it. I think he was. Had he thrown it earlier, He would have had a chance.
He would have because
he waited too late.
I think he would have because he had. Nickell Robey Coleman did not have a good angle on the ball. That's why he didn't make a play on the ball.
He didn't even see it. Had he thrown it a couple seconds, like a second earlier, that might be a touchdown.
I
don't think the Rams recover if the Saints score.
Because Saints had the better defense. So I'm going in the basement level, so I'm probably going to lose you. So.
All
right. Have a good night. Get home safe. Touchdowns and Panthers. Shout out to FTC. Shout out to S-Squad. Shout out to Good News Radio Station. I'm out. Peace.
Peace. All right. It literally sounded like Pete was being human trafficked to some unknown location, like in the movie Taken. I was like, I wanted to be like, Pete, calm down. They're going to take you. But nah, I'm just kidding. But anyway, man, I'm going to wrap things up real quick. But there was actually... For the Senior Bowl, there was about 11 guys who were there. Tyree Jackson, the Buffalo quarterback, who put his name in the transfer pool and then decided to just declare for the draft. Tony Pollard, the Memphis running back. I think Craig Davis, I forget his first name, but he was Iowa defensive lineman. A bunch of redshirt juniors. And more cats were taking advantage of that. So that's a good trend. There was a record like 153 underclassmen who declared for the draft. But I think more of the athletes are being more aware that they can fully take advantage of that transfer rule. And I'm happy for them. And also the cats who feel like you'll strike while the iron's hot. And it's good that the Senior Bowl kind of changed their criteria, letting in redshirt juniors who get done with academics and they graduate and then they can go. That's dope too. That's really great to see. One thing, and it's kind of really pissed me off, is lawsuit that the Saints, the governor got behind, you know, for the NFL suing for them to like replay the game. Personally, I just want to know where was all this outrage when Alton Sterling got murdered, when the Black Lives a couple good black men, great black men who were activists in Missouri, which by the way, they're targeting all the activists, all the black people they've been targeting them since, you know, the protests in Missouri, and they've been killing people. I don't need to say who when I say they, I think you kind of know what I mean, but yeah, there was a couple black guys in Louisiana shot in the head in broad daylight, set on fire in his car, but nobody saw anything. I didn't see the governor of Louisiana rushing to get anything done then. Alton Sterling murdered in cold blood on camera in front of all of us to see, clearly by some racist white supremacist cops. But I didn't see the outrage from the governor then. But I see the outrage from the governor, the team, and the fans over a punk-ass pass interference call, which, yeah, it was bad, but guess what? The Saints had a chance in overtime to actually do something, and they didn't. They kind of gave the ball back to the Rams, and they couldn't stop them. And Todd Gurley played like crap, so there's that. I just personally thought that was trash, and I think it just really is trash that Louisiana's getting hype over that. I didn't see the governor getting all hype when Joe McKnight, former USC running back, Rose Bowl hero, former Jets running back, Chiefs running back, you know, a man who has a child, was murdered by his white supremacist. And yeah, that dude's in prison now, but, you know, I didn't see the outrage for that. But I see the outrage over a blown call in a playoff game, in a home game. But hey, you know, that's just me. I don't like to make everything about race, but I do know that everything, when it comes to being black, other people outside of that make it an issue. My blackness is an issue to other people, not to me. It's an issue to the police, kind of like in Chicago, where the dude, Van Dyke, gets, what, three, pretty much 7 years, but he's really only going to do 3 for murdering Laquan McDonald. And the DA and the prosecutor, everybody was kind of in cahoots, pretty much just like, you know what, yeah, we wanted justice for everybody, but Laquan McDonald's dead, but Van Dyke only gets 7 years. And the media, they literally said, they trumped it up to where, like, oh my God, he got 7 years for murdering someone. And then they tried to cover it up the whole way. But anyway, I digress. Keep your head on a swivel out there. And, you know, don't trust the police as much as you think you should. Have everything recorded. I'm being serious. And if you really feel unsafe when you're being stopped by the police, you can actually call 911 because they record all calls. You can call 911 while you're being accosted by a police officer. That's actually, it's a thing you can do. And they will record everything that happens. But anyway, on to something a little less dark. And I'll really make this quick because it's already 10 o'clock. But I actually started back at CSUN this week. It's been kind of a really emotional week for me. I already have 5 more gray hairs on my head. No cap, I'm not even playing. Like, I looked in the mirror, and now I just have a patch of where my hair is, like, a little bit grayer. Yeah, and I'm only 26. Wow. But shout out to my older sister, Courtney. Her birthday is in 2 days, and she'll be 30. Man, like, I feel 30 just, like, stalking me from around the corner. It's weird. But, yeah, started school this week. Was really hyped. After 2 years away, I've been through a lot at CSUN and been put through a lot by that journalism department and, you know, the powers that be. I got done dirty. I'll probably tell more of it when I graduate in May, or at least the last part of the story. But, you know, the funny thing is, because Monday was MLK Day, Tuesday I went to class, and I show up to class, and one of the professors who's been there for a while, he's like patting me on the shoulder. He's like, good to see you back. And that made me feel, that kind of calmed me down. I was like, all right, I can handle this. And then I get to class, and I see the big blue paper on the door. And if you go to CSUN, if you've been in college, you know what that big blue paper means. Class was canceled. Yeah, I'm paying like $2,200 over $2,000 for these two classes that I have. And the class was canceled for this week, both my classes. It was so anticlimactic. And it was so like, yeah, this is something that would happen to me in my life that I couldn't help but laugh. I chuckled. Because I'm just like, yeah, God probably knew I needed a break. I was stressed. Working between 2 jobs, you know, touchdowns and tangents, how things are taking off. I'm blessed. I can truly say that. A lot of the hard work I've been putting in is finally starting to pay off. Man, I'm just thankful to the people who have my back. Even when a lot of the people who thought I would have my back all turned their back on me and just totally acted like, you know, like I was a pariah. And you know, you don't forget things like that. And it kind of makes you a little bit bitter inside. I can admit that. But for me, for this moment, and it was crazy because Pete and, you know, I had work at my other job, so I couldn't actually go to the bowl game. But I actually got press credentials to the NFL PA collegiate game. He sent me a screenshot. And it's crazy because, like, I applied, got it on my first try. I didn't hear back from them. I only knew I got it because he sent me the screenshot. And I was like, damn, there's my name right there. This year, I would have been covering the NFL Collegiate PA Bowl game. Next year, I'm like, not only will I be covering it, hell, I might be at the Senior Bowl. Might be at the NFL Combine. So I'm going to keep my goals high. Because for me, one of the things that really troubled me is that I felt like maybe I have really high and intense goals that feel unrealistic. And when I don't reach them in the time that I want to, I feel like I failed. But in a lot of those times, when you have those really high goals, don't necessarily put a time stamp on it right out the gate, because life happens and you can't really dictate where things are going to go. So I would say just, you know, take the feeling of you needing to have something done at this exact second, at this exact moment in time, because you don't know where you're going to be in 6 months or 6 seconds. You hope to be certain places at certain times. But in my case, I put off school for an extra 2 years after sitting out a semester, then going back. And I'm dealing with a lot. I'm dealing with a lot of emotions, mixed emotions. Some of it anger, some of it regret, some of it remorse, some of it just a lot. Like every time I touch campus. But last semester when I was like, I was really hating my job there, and I'm like, I can't wait to leave this place. Now I have like a renewed sense of just happiness, because I see what I'm working for is closer than ever. And I know it's going to be harder than ever to finally get there, but I'm happy. I'm excited, and I'm grateful that I'm still here and still making it. Yeah. So with that, I just want to say shout out to all the middle children out there. And I'm just going to play out to some J. Cole, Middle Child. It's fire. Touchdowns and Tangents. Shout out to Full Press Coverage. Shout out to Obi. Amazing interview. Amazing, amazing interview. Amazing journalist. He got me hype. I kind of want to go to HBCU now. And shout out to everybody else at Good News Radio, Good News Sports, everybody that did go to an HBCU. Shout out to the fellas at the Get Right, Kentucky State. But yeah, man, this is Kenneth Frank James Berry signing off for the night. Y'all stay safe out there. And, you know, keep your head on a swivel. And the middle child is awesome. Sorry, older sibling and younger sibling, but the middle child is awesome. There, I said it.
You good, T-Minus? Niggas been counting me out, I'm counting my bullets, I'm loading my clips, I'm writing down names, I'm making a list, I'm checking it twice and I'm getting them hit. The real ones been dying, the fake ones is lit, the game is off balance, I'm back on my shit. The Bentley is dirty, my sneakers is dirty, but that's how I like it, you all on my dick, I'm all in my bag, as hard as it get, I do not